So, very good. Welcome to everybody. So that's the seventh lecture. I hope you see the screen correctly. So today we're going to talk about the open string side of the story for what super string dbrains are concerned. So the idea is to ask, so given a dbrain system, there are obvious questions. So what kind of open strings something peculiar to the superstring, what kind of GSO projection for this open string? Okay. So the structure is always the same. Let's consider a two-brain system just for concreteness. So we have a DP1 and some DP2 as usual. So here we can imagine a bulk space-time that can be either type to A or type to B. And then the open strings are exactly as in the bosonic case. So there are four kinds of open strings, and therefore the open strings arrange themselves into four Hilbert spaces that can be arranged into a Chan pattern matrix. So we'll have Hilbert space 1-1, Hilbert space 1-2, Hilbert space 2-1, and Hilbert space 2-2. And right, so any one of these space, so Hij, will undergo some GSO projection. Okay, and this GSO projection, we will now see in various examples that, so this GSO, the origin of this GSO projection has essentially two origins. The first one is obvious, depends on whether we are in type 2A or in type 2B, of course. But there is another origin for GSO projection that deals with the kind of dbrains where the strings are stretching. So this depends on the kind of dbrains, okay? So the strategy now is that we will see examples and we will see how this GSO projection arises, okay? The rigorous justification for this GSO projection again come from the analysis of a one loop amplitude, okay, which we have not yet done, so we won't be able really to justify why this GSO projection arises, but so the idea is that if I have a brain DP1 and a brain DP2, I can imagine open string forming going to do a loop in this way. Okay, and the corresponding one loop amplitude will require peculiar GSO projections depending on the kind of boundary condition of the D2 brain. So if you want, so now I will tell you which will be the GSO projection for the kind of stretched strings. And you have to imagine that this is not my choice, but this is really something that is obtained by looking at these one loop partition functions, okay. Tomorrow we will perhaps see just at the very end this the face of this one loop partition functions, but at the moment I just have to proceed like this. Okay, so now I'm going to take some simple dbrain system and analyze it for you. Okay, so the first simple system which we have already encountered in the case of the bosonic string, so now we will just see what changes in the superstring, is the parallel DP-DP system. And okay, so in this case, we have an open string field, psi open, which is, as I told you, a matrix made with four blocks. H11, H12, H21, H22. Now, we know that from the bulk perspective, we know that there is one half SUSY preserved. Therefore, we would expect the open string theory on this D-brain system to be some theory that preserves half SUSY, okay? So we expect open strings to preserve SUSY as well. Okay, so this is realized. So then how are these open strings arranged? So in this case, the GSO is the same for all four blocks, H, I, J. And right, so what is this GSO projection? In the Neveshwar sector, it is the nice one that keeps the vector and throw away the tachyon. And in the Ramon sector, you remember there are two choices, and these two choices are both realized. So you can have GSO R plus. So this is the GSO projection that is relative to the open string sitting on a D brain, on a, let's say, on a, not on a D brain, on a charged D brain, charged D brain. So these are BPS brain. We are talking about BPS D brain. So the one that carries Ramon charge. And then the other choice can also be realized, of course. You cannot realize both of them at the same time, but you can choose between one and the other. And the other choice is the one that you need for the anti-D brains. So you see, you use everything. Okay, so then what is the spectrum on a, if we have a single DP brain, what do we find? So in the NS sector, we get let's say, a 10-dimensional vector. But this 10-dimensional vector, by obvious dimensional reduction, considering a space-time coordinates, only the Neumann coordinates will just become, this is precisely as in the bosonic string, a mu phi I. Okay, so this will be the gauge boson on the DP brain. And these are the transverse scalars for the transverse position, of the D brain. And again, what happens on the other end in the Ramon sector? Well, in the Ramon sector, if we want, we start with a chiral spinor in D equal 10. Okay, we had used alpha for the 10-dimensional indices in D equal 10. And then this chiral spinor in D equal 10 will split, okay, will split depending on our choice of Neumann Dirichlet condition. But in general, it will split into spinors in D. So this will be in D equal P plus one, where this A will really be spin of SO one comma P, and this will be reinterpreted as some flavor. Okay. And right, these spinors, of course, can have opposite chirality, right, in 10 dimension, okay, depending on whether we have brains or anti-brains, okay, so different chirality depending on brain, anti-brain. And therefore, this different chirality then reflects in the way the spinner decomposes in lower dimension, okay? Right, so now I think it's time to discuss the nicest of all of nicest possible D-brain system. That is something that then you will use also later in Lacey's lectures with the lectures of Alicia and Jan about ADS-CFT. So let's discuss the multiple D3 brains as an example of this this generic D-brain systems that preserves half of the bulk supersymmetry. So these are M equal to mu and I, where mu goes 1, 2, 3 and 4. Wait, no, yes. 1, 2, 3, and 3, yes. And I goes from 4 to 10. So these are Neumann directions. These are Dirichlet direction. Okay, so what happens in this case? So our 10-dimensional Lorentz group is broken by the presence of these solitons, right? By these D brains that breaks translational invariance and also Lorentz invariance. So then it breaks, of course, to the SO1, 3 times SO6. And so this will become Lorentz, and this will become some flavor again. Let's just have a look, concrete look at the massless spectrum. So what we find in the NS sector, two possibilities. So the first possibility is a non-abelian gauge boson times its vertex operator, e to the minus phi, e to the I p dot x at the boundary. Then plus, then we have another component when the leg is on the transverse direction. This will give rise to non-abelian scalars, fi of p, c psi I, e to the minus phi, e to the I p dot x of x. And okay, so just remember that this has to be interpreted as an insertion of this vertex operator on the boundary. So here I have D3 boundary conditions, okay, means Neumann and Dirichlet according to, okay, and here I insert here in this point X this vertex operator here. Okay, so that's the most generic state that I can write at level one. So this is the lowest possible state in the GSO NS plus sector. Okay, remember that now my ground state in the GSO NS plus sector is really this kind of state, because the tachyon is no more there. And therefore I have to ask under which condition this state is physical, as usual. So we have already did it, this thing, so I just go quick. And so because we analyze precisely the chiral side of the bulk theory, which is exactly the same in this case, it turns out to be exactly the same as the boundary algebra in this case. So QB is equal to zero when P square, of course, is equal to zero. And when these guys here obey the transversality condition, P mu, A mu, sorry, A mu of P equal to zero. So very good. So that's the same spectrum essentially that we were finding in the bosonic string. So we are going to find n squared gauge bosons. And 6 times n squared transverse scalars. Okay, so exactly as in the bosonic string, here we are going, so switching on interactions, okay? We can imagine that we can switch on interaction now, and then this gauge boson will interact in a way which is the one of UN Young-Mills. Okay, tomorrow we will precisely see that the interaction is really Young-Mills, okay? So we will see really the non-abelian interaction between these gauge bosons. For the moment, I just tell you. Plus scalars. Okay, so that's nothing so fancy. That's just the same story as the bosonic string. So now we can have a look at the Ramon sector. So in this case, let's say that we are on D3 brain and non anti-D3 brain. Of course, we can have a stack. So we have to imagine to have a stack of n D3 brains. Therefore, the Ramond sector, we'll have to choose GSO Ramond, let's say plus. I'm not sure whether plus or minus is the one for D3 or anti-D3, but that's really not important. Okay, so what is important is the form of the vertex operator in 10 dimensions. So in 10 dimensions, we would write a gaugeino. So this would be the gaugeino of D equal 10 super Young-Mills, okay? But now we will soon decompose it to see what we get in 4 dimension. E to the minus phi over 2, e to the I p dot x in x, okay? So that's a vertex operator that is completely analogous to the its Neve-Schwarz partner. You see there is a C ghost times something of weight one, also here C ghost and something of weight one and the momentum mode. So you see that at the end of the day, this vertex operator is a sort of universal structure, even if they belong to Ramon or Neve-Schwarz sector. And okay, so this alpha here is in the 16C of SO1,9. Okay, so what does it mean? So now we have to see, now we have to do SO1,9 to, we have to SO1,3 times SO6.
Excuse me?
Yes? Sorry.
Can I ask a quick question?
Please.
I don't quite understand why there's n square gauge bosons and 6 n square transverse scalars.
Oh, they are n square because if you have n d brains, you have so n d brains, you have an n times n Chan pattern matrix.
Okay.
Okay, and in every slot there is going to be a state of this form, right? So this big A, this big
yes.
A that I wrote like this is an n by n matrix.
Okay. Okay.
Is it clear now?
Yeah, it is.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Very good. So okay, so now we have to see this transverse scalar. So well, that's a standard group theory, but here, I mean, the spin fields make this thing very explicit, because if you remember, this S alpha was written in as E to the plus minus I over 2, we called it HH1. E to the plus minus I over 2 H5, okay? So that means that here we can read off directly in this bosonized description, we can read off directly the spin or weight of this spin of this index here, okay? So this alpha is, so this means that this alpha, as we have already discussed, is plus minus 1/2, plus minus 1/2, plus minus 1/2, plus minus 1/2, plus minus 1/2. I think these are okay, very good. And so what does it mean to do a NSO1,3 times SO6 decomposition? Well, it just means to put a division here, okay? So this will be the 4 dimensional spinor, And this is some flavor. Okay, so in particular, from here we get the spinor representation of SO, 3, and from here, so here this will give a spinor representation of SO6, but in fact a spinor representation of SO6 is best understood as the fundamental or anti-fundamental of SU4, okay? So what happens is that this SO6 is a universal cover, right, which is SU4, and so alpha, in fact, then. So now you see that a single chirality in 10 dimension, that means, let's say, having an even number, so we are having now even number of minus one half. Okay, so that means we are in the 16C of SO1,9. So that means that, but now you see that this even number of minus one half, you can realize it in two ways. Okay, you can either have an even number of minus one half only in this sector here, or you can distribute them, the even numbers, you know, from here to here. So the bottom line is that you get two representation, one which is, let's say, chiral even in four dimension times some fundamental index of SU4, plus anti-chiral in four dimension times an anti-fundamental index of SU4, okay? So as I was telling you, this I is, let's say, vial plus of SO6, which is essentially the same as the four of SU4, and I bar is vial minus of SO6, which is the four bar of SU4. Okay, I'm sure all of you knows these things, but it's always better to make them explicit. So if you are in SO6, you have this Dynkin diagram here, where here you have the 4C and the 4S. These are the two spinorial representation of SO6, and this is the vectorial representation. But in SU4, you have the same Dynkin diagram, okay? We have the same Dynkin diagram that for graphical reason, you write it like this, but this 4C just becomes the 4, and this, okay, so this is this, and here you get the 4 bar, and here you get six-dimensional representation in the middle. So, okay, so what does it mean, this thing? It means that this chi alpha that we wrote here, this space-time polarization, this space-time field in 10 dimension, this was a spinor in 10 dimension, okay, this chi alpha now becomes chi a I comma chi a dot. I bar, okay? So we get four left-handed plus four bar right-handed gauging. Okay, so these are the supersymmetric partners of the gauge boson, okay? Right, so collecting collecting everything, we have everything then. So if we put together Neve-Schwarz plus Ramond, then you can see that essentially you have all the matter content of N equal 4 UN super Yamils, okay, which is this theory here that I have written down, that you have already seen during the lectures of supersymmetry with Sarah. okay, so the in string theory, of course, so the idea is that the string's amplitude reproduces all these interactions, all these interactions course, plus an infinite set of alpha prime corrections, okay? That is the difference between field theory and string theory. Okay, so I'm sure you have already discussed a lot of properties of this theory, so I don't want to enter more in details, and so, but you just know that this theory is a super conformal invariant, so it has a beta function that is equal to zero, okay? So in fact, this is a one parameter family of theories, and one for every value of the G. So just what I call G string there is in fact essentially G and Mills squared. And right, and you see, okay, so this is, so you form, so the matter content that you have can be arranged in the form of an equal form multiplet like this. Alpha dot A bar and phi A, okay, so going from the spin, so here you have spin one, spin one half, and spin zero, okay, so this is what you can do with four supercharges in 10 dimensions, okay, very good. So that was a very standard construction. So now I would like to discuss a less trivial system, which is a DD bar system. Okay, so you can imagine now that we have a D brain and an anti D brain. So now we have again the usual strings. Okay, and we can arrange the strings in four sectors again phi DD bar. Phi D bar D and phi D bar D bar. And right, so now what can we say about this system? Oh, right, we know already that from the bulk point of view, SUSY is broken, right? SUSY is completely broken because the two D brains, they preserve precisely the opposite halves of supersymmetry or supercharges, so in total they break everything, it's broken. And well, so so then we expect no SUSY for open strings. So now we expect the effective theory of open strings on these D brains to be some non-supersymmetric theory. And to see this effective theory, then we have to see what are the states that this open string belongs to and the Hilbert space where, and so I just tell you what is the result. So for phi DD, we have GSO NS plus, so these are exactly the same strings as before. So these are strings stretched between the same D brain. So you have GSO R plus, and for phi D bar D bar, so these are strings stretched on the D bar. So this is again GSO NS plus plus, but this time we choose different chirality in the Ramon sector because this is an anti brain. Okay, so then the fun starts when we have to consider stretched string. In this case, okay, modular, I mean essentially consistency of one loop amplitude tells you that you have to pick the opposite GSO projection, the one that you have always discarded up to now. Okay, so this is the one that take out the throw away the vector and keeps the tachyon. And here we have Ramon sector in one chirality, and we can have phi d bar d, and this is GSO ns again minus plus GSO R minus, okay? Don't want to enter in details, but it turns out that this is traced with this appropriate Champaton factor. This is a perfectly fine operator algebra for boundary fields, even if you have this GSO minus sector. But, right, okay, so this is the big difference between a DD bar system and a DD between a DD bar system and a DD system, okay, that the stretched strings are in the wrong GSO, okay? So these are the stretched strings. So the stretched strings are really red here, okay? So they are there is a tachyon here. Okay. So this is not a tachyon that we are supposed to just not think about as we were doing for the bosonic string, which was more or less an academic exercise towards the superstring. This is a serious thing, right? So here we are in a stable space-time, okay, which is bulk, which is type 2A or type 2B bulk. Then we have a system of 2D brains, which breaks supersymmetry completely. And this system has a tachyon in the spectrum. Okay. Moreover, this system, so this DD bar, so what are the quality of this guy? So it has no Ramon charge. And therefore, and no Susie, tachyon in the open string sector. Okay, so these are all signs that essentially tells me that this D bar system is unstable. Okay, and therefore is the tachyon is precisely this, right? So the tachyon is precisely the manifestation of the instability of the system. And therefore, we will have the brain decay. Okay. So this decay of the brain is something that you can imagine, something that is triggered by this tachyon field. Okay. So now we are going to discuss a little bit. And so this the brain decay is a name. It's called tachyon condensation. Okay, so what is the physics of this tachyon condensation? So it has to do, to discuss about tachyon condensation, you need a concept, which is the tachyon effective potential. Okay, now this is a key quantity to discuss the physics of this unstable system. So you may ask how you are able to compute, how can you compute this tachyon effective potential from string theory? And in fact, the real answer is that you cannot really compute it from the kind of string theory we are doing. So just computing, let's say, on-shell amplitude. You need an off-shell formulation of string theory to compute this tachyon effective potential, which is called string field theory. Okay, but it's an upgrade to all the things that we have seen in this lecture, so it's not something completely detached from it. But okay, so now, since we don't really time even to introduce the concept of string field theory, I just say the word, but just think about it as a tool that allows you to get a space-time effective action for the low energy modes of the string, and the tachyon belongs in. So if the D-brain system is unstable, then the tachyon have to be included in the fields that you retain in the infrared at low energy. And so that's what you get, okay? So the tachyon here, as I told you, is belongs to the off diagonal sector of the Champaton matrix. So you can say that the tachyon is a 2x2 field that has this form. So that's the tachyon field as a 2x2 matrix, okay? Because here we are in a 2x2 system because it's a 2D brain system. So this is the tachyon field. So you see the tachyon field is complex, as you have T and T bar, and it has a potential. So this is the form of the potential that you get. I'm sorry for the very bad writing, but is this the usual Mexican head potential, the same you get in many other systems. So here in the base, this is the space of tachyons. Okay, this is the potential. So tachyon effect, so the idea is that at T equals zero, so this is the DD bar system. The top of the hill is precisely the unstable system. And now, okay, so if you are allowed to go off shell and with thanks to the string field theory, you can integrate out all the massive modes, and then you're left with the low energy modes. And this low energy mode will show up a potential that has precisely this form, okay? This has been seen actually from in numerical studies from string field theory. This potential has been obtained. And okay, so then, but then you see this potential is a vacuum manifold of minima here, okay? So this, which is an S1, and there is a height, okay, so this height here, okay? So, okay, so you can imagine now you have a scalar field theory, okay, and with this tachyon field theory, a scalar field theory with this potential, and then you can study the classical solution of the scalar field theory, okay? So the simplest solution that you get are the constant solution. Okay, so this constant solution, what does it mean? It just means that T is equal to T star. So T star is this value here. So it's just the value of the minimum. And already you can compute this quantity, the difference in energy. So you can compute the difference in the potential between the unstable vacuum and this stable vacuum, T star. And you think how much should I get here? Someone can tell me. Okay, so you will just get this difference of energies will just be equal to the tension of the DD bar system, okay? So that means that this vacuum, in fact, this is a conjecture, okay? This is a conjecture that has been, let's say, proved numerically, but still we don't have the full analytic proof of it. But this is called the first sense conjecture. Okay, so the tachyon effective potential is a minimum, and the energy difference between the unstable vacuum and the stable vacuum precisely accounts for the total energy of the DD bar system, okay? So that means that this constant solution represents no D-brains at all, okay? So that's a configuration on a D-brain system in which the D-brain has disappeared, okay? So that's the vacuum, that's the time-independent vacuum where all D-brains are away. And okay, so this interpretation allows for the second sense conjecture, which is precisely making more precise this idea that at this solution here, there are no more D-brains. So, and if there are no more D-brains, it means that there are no open strings. Okay, so that means that if you see this tachyon effective potential as a classical field theory for open strings, or better, if you think about the open string field theory on this D-brain system, and you go to this tachyon vacuum solution, then you would expect that expanding the theory around this classical solution, then you would find no physical states. So no perturbative on-shell fluctuations. Okay. Okay, and okay, so that makes sense, right? We have an unstable system in our D-brain spectrum. We have an unstable state. This state is unstable, so it decays. It does not have any charge protecting it, right? Because there is no Ramon charge. So in general, it can decay. But that's the nice thing is that this is not the only solution of this potential, right? So of course that's not the only solution of this potential. There are other solutions, and here is the third sense conjecture. That there are non-trivial solutions describing lower dimensional deep brains. And so now we are going to discuss one of them, which is pretty tailor-made for this kind of Dystakian effective potential, that are the so-called vortex solutions. Okay, so what are these vortex solutions? Well, okay, so you have this potential here. Okay, I don't even want to write down a formula for this potential, but you know, this is the usual phi squared minus phi cube phi four potential. And so our tachyon field is a field on the on this direction mu, which is equal to zero p. Okay, so these are the word volume coordinates. And okay, so before we just considered t not depending on x at all, and we just found that the only solution was the bottom of the potential, of course. Okay, so now we search for fancier solution, for more non-trivial solution, that are solution that depends on two variables, x1 and x2. Okay, so we excite, so we give a profile to the tachyon field along two directions that belong to the word volume of the DD bar system. Okay, so that essentially means going to complex coordinate that we see the tachyon as x times e to the I theta. Right, so again, I'm not going to write down the final form of the solution. That's not so important. What is important is to make some topological consideration by looking at this. Okay, so these are, so we have two separated two-dimensional spaces. One is this two-dimensional space that I have used here, and the other one is the tachyon space. Okay, it's the space where the tachyon live. Okay, so in this space where the tachyon live, we have already seen from the form of the potential that there is this this manifold, this U1 of minima. Okay, so therefore, if we want to have a normalizable solution, better that this solution sits down at the minima when x goes to infinity. Okay, so we want something that is local. So we want the energy to be localized. Okay, so that means that when x goes to infinity, the solution, this field configuration will have to be some t star, which is the modulus of the vacuum, and then there is also this phase, okay, which, okay, this we didn't discuss it for the constant solution. This phase turns out to be just a gauge parameter for the constant solution. But here on the other end, it plays an extremely important role, because now you see that these solutions, so essentially to get a normalizable solution, I have to say how this theta angle in the x1 x2 plane is related to this theta v angle in the tachyon space. Okay, and so therefore the solutions so there are many solutions of that have this form, and they are classified by the winding number. Okay, so it is the number winding number, so the solution is so you need a map from the S1 in the X1, X2 space to the S1 in the tachyon space. And these maps are of course classified by the winding number, right? How many times the S1 wraps. I mean, how many times this S1 here wrap clockwise on anti-clockwise or clockwise around the variety of the minima, okay? So that means that in general, we will have solution Tn of x1, x2, labeled by this winding number, where n is an integer number. Okay, So these are called, so these are classical solitons in classical field theory that probably many of you already know. These are called vortex solutions, these solitons. So this, independently of the fact that this is attached to an effective field theory, these solitons are called vortex solutions. And so, but now here in string theory, this N is a very nice interpretation, right? Because N can be positive or it can be negative. And let's just think about these solutions. Okay, so this solution represent, so these are field configuration where the tachyon is at the minimum of its potential far away at infinity. So that means that this solution represents some concentration of mass energy close to here. Okay, so here is where mass and energy is stored. Okay, mass energy is here. Okay, but now you see that this solution does not have only mass energy, that is just the mass energy that you can compute from the action, but it has also a topological charge that is this winding. Okay, so from this tachyon effective field theory, and in fact from the full open string field theory, one expects to find these classical solutions that has a charge density concentrated close to the origin, and also a topological charge that can be positive or negative. Okay, so therefore it is completely natural to interpret this n positive as n dp minus two brains, and this thing as n anti dp minus two brains. Okay, so right, and so that's how. And so you see, that's nice, because then you see brains emerging as classical solutions inside the theory of bigger D brains. Okay, so that's nice. So let me spend last word. So this idea then generalize. So one can consider open string field theory on a set of equal number of anti-D9, and the idea is that from tachyon condensation, all type to be brains are reproduced. Okay. Plus also the closed string vacuum itself. Okay. So this is, if you want, is the content of okay, so that's the 2B side of the story. There is an analogous type 2A side of the story, where instead of starting with the D9 anti-D9, you start with a non-BPS D9 brain, okay, which is this uncharged DP brain that we discussed yesterday, and this also from tachyon condensation, you can all reproduce all type 2A brains. Okay, so these are the so-called sense conjecture. This is one way of presenting sense conjecture. Okay, and okay, so what is the status of these conjectures? So they have been for the superstring, they have been numerically checked using string field theory, and other indirect methods also. Okay. But the nice thing is that in the case of the bosonic string, where things are a little bit easier, all the three have been analytically proven. Okay, so people have been able really to solve explicitly the equation of motion of open string field theory and find this Tuckian vacuum solution, then show that around the Tuckian vacuum solution there are no perturbative degrees of freedom, and then show that all kind of bosonic debranes can be written as an explicit solution as the open string field theory described, I mean, they define it on any given debrain system. So that's very encouraging. And of course, people now would like to understand how this extends to the superstring. And right, so why this is, so maybe, so this gives a new picture of debrains essentially. So from this picture, debrains are understood as classical solutions of a microscopic open string field theory. Okay, and right, so debrains, so the message is that this analysis suggests that debrains can also be considered not just as we didn't discuss this in this course, but I'm sure you know, and so debrains are typically, so the field theory interpretation, so when you talk about debrains as solution, you are imagining them as supergravity solutions, okay? So solutions to some clustering theory. So supergravity is the effective field theory of supergravity. But here I'm giving you a different perspective. Here I'm suggesting you to see debrains as open string solitons, not clustering solitons. It's open string solitons, okay? And in fact, the even dimensional analysis, even the things that we see suggest that you should do this, right? Because you remember that we discussed the tension of a P brain. And I told you that this tension goes like 1/G string. But in fact, in open string language, G string is precisely 1/G open square, okay? So you see, this is exactly the mass. This is the classical dependence of on this is the classical dependence for classical solitons. Okay, so if you have a classical field theory, you'll have 1/G square in front. You will search for classical solution. Classical solution will typically have an energy that goes like 1/coupling constant square. This is precisely what happens for debrains. So this open string field theory picture gives you a way to realize this, okay? And okay, so I think that this is what I wanted to say for on this. And okay, I still have 3 minutes, but I don't think it's worth starting a new subject. So I think I can end up here, and then there is some time for questions. Stop recording.